Welcome to another session of Studio Sessions. This is a program that highlights unique and special people, poets and authors, historians, musicians, magicians, people who have something unique to say. My name is Richard Sennett, and I'm your host tonight, and we have a very special guest on the program. His name is Craig Walker. We're here to talk about your most recent work and the unique person you've heralded in this work. Her name was Dr. Ethel Percy Andrus. Am I pronouncing that right?
Ethel Percy Andrus.
Well, thank you for coming on. Now tell us, how did you become motivated to write this particular book?
Well, I was writing a book for the Ojai Museum called Postcards. It was a postcard history of Ojai. And one of the postcards that I came upon was a picture of Gray Gables. And I had to find out a little something about it in order to write a caption for that postcard. And in learning about that, I discovered that it had been the brainchild and the creation of this woman, Ethel Percy Andrus, who at that time in the 1950s was running Gray Gables in Ojai and the National Retired Teachers Association. So I got interested in that, and the museum then asked me to give a talk at their annual meeting, and I decided to give the talk about Dr. Andrus, so I researched her even more. And I felt a very strong connection with her because I'm a retired teacher. And she was a retired principal that took an interest in conditions for retired teachers back in the 1940s. And she resolved to do something about them because they were really pretty bad. So I felt a real affinity for her. And also I was fascinated because it turns out that Dr. Andrus founded AARP, the largest nonprofit membership organization in America.
Well, AARP is the association?
American Association for Retired Persons, of Retired Persons.
And that started in Ojai?
That started in Ojai in 1958. And so they're celebrating their 60th anniversary this year. So they asked me to write this book about Dr. Andrus, this biography. So the result is this book. I did the writing along with a friend of mine who helped with that, and AARP put all the graphics and the book together, and it's just being published now.
It's a beautiful book. It's got a picture of the lady on the front.
Yeah.
She was one of the first women doctors in education?
She was one of the first women to earn a doctorate in education at USC. At the time she was a principal, she'd been a principal for 28 years at Lincoln High School in Los Angeles. And she decided to become more educated herself and to set a good example for her students. So she first went back to USC and got a master's in education, and then continued on and got her doctorate in education.
Fascinating woman. What can you tell us about her? What was her background? Was she a Californian?
Well, she was born in California, in San Francisco, in 1881. And when she was about 9 years old, her father moved her family back to Chicago, where he was going to pursue his law degree at Northwestern. This was in 1890. And she went to school there, and she graduated from high school in Chicago. And she was in Chicago right at the time of the progressive movement. Mm-hmm. She got accepted at the University of Chicago, which at that time was being run by John Dewey, who's known as the father of progressive education. She also volunteered for many years working at Hull House for Jane Addams. And in fact, much of her personality, much of her philosophy of life and work, you can trace back to John Dewey and Jane Addams. And
what was Hull House?
Hull House was a settlement house. Jane Addams was a social reformer. There were a lot of immigrants coming into Chicago, mm-hmm. and their lives were atrocious, and because they spoke a foreign language. They couldn't really become amalgamated into American life. And Jane Addams had gone traveling to England and came upon what's called a settlement house in England called Toynbee Hall. And a settlement house is a place where social workers, upper middle class and upper class people who are interested in social reform, would go live at this house in the middle of the neighborhood of the immigrants. And they would create programs. They would create a community center, really, where the local immigrants could come and they could learn how to become amalgamated into American culture.
So they could learn English?
They could learn English. They could learn about American government. And then the people who were working there would learn about them and could learn how to create programs for them and how to make life better for them. And Ethel Andrus was teaching at a very progressive college. It was the first community college in America called the Lewis Institute. It was a four-year high school with 2 years of college afterwards that would then lead into the University of Chicago. And that's the pattern that started all over America and California. It was originally, like, I think Ventura High School had two post high school years that were Ventura College. Eventually it broke off and you had the community college just those first
but
2 years
been
of
so
college.
Successful throughout the West.
Yeah, and she taught there at the Lewis Institute, and she would take her drama students to Hull House to perform for the residents there and for the people who came from the neighborhood. And then she volunteered there, and so she learned about this technique of social reform, where you really work hands-on, you get people connected to their communities and learning how to become Americans. When she became the principal of Lincoln High School in Los Angeles, she basically turned the high school into a settlement house along the same pattern as Hull House. So it wasn't just a school, but it was a community center, and the students would put on programs that, because Lincoln High School at that time was located in an area of Los Angeles with a lot of immigrant families as well. And so her goal was not only to educate the students, but to educate their families as well and to get them involved with America and with community life. So that
and being local, they could actually meet the needs of the people right there. It wasn't someone from a faraway place dictating what needs to be done. They could see what needed to be accomplished and make it fit the needs of the population.
Right, and she actually started one of the first night schools at a high school for adults. So she not only wanted to educate, like I said, the high school students, but she created this night school for the adults living in the community to come and learn English, learn trades. She was also a pioneer in offering vocational education. So Lincoln High School offered just so many different courses in the trades, not just in auto shop, welding, but also things like marketing, what we would think of as a real career center for the students. So she was very progressive and she was a pioneer. For many years, people thought she was the first woman principal in California, but our research showed that there had been other women high school principals before her, but they were usually the principals of small rural schools out in the middle of the Central Valley. She was the first of a large urban high school, the first principal, and she was very successful at it.
She sounds like a very dynamic individual.
Very dynamic. She was high energy. She was the old saying that if you want something done, ask a busy person. That was Dr. Andrus. She was on so many boards. She was on the County General Hospital Board in Los Angeles. She authored articles for different education journals. Later on, when she started AARP, she practically wrote Modern Maturity, which was their magazine, herself. Mm-hmm. And it still is. It's now called AARP Magazine, not Modern Maturity anymore, but it's the largest circulation magazine in the country. And it was back when she was alive, too.
And so, now what is her link to Ojai? She was born in San Francisco, grew up in Chicago, got her education there, came to Los Angeles. Where does Ojai fit in?
Okay, well, she was a principal for 28 years at Lincoln High School. In 1944, her mother became ill, and the nurse who was taking care of her said, oh, you're too busy to take care of your mother, so I'll just deal with her, you go off to work. And Ethel resolved that day to quit her job. So she went in and she resigned from her teaching job to take care of her mother. And she brought her mother back to life, basically. And her mother got over her illness. And it was her mother that turned to her and said, you know, older people need you now. You know, you need to do for older people what you did for younger people. And that made sense to her. And so she started just being a welfare director for the California Retired Teachers Association. And she would go out and she would investigate cases. You got to understand that teachers in 1944 were really in a bad position. They only got $40 a month as a pension. They didn't have any health insurance. And the Depression had pretty much wiped out any savings that they had. And teachers, as with most groups, had mandatory retirement up until the time she changed that. So a lot of teachers were really in bad straits, and she would go around and try to hunt out people that needed help, retired teachers that needed assistance, whether it be medical or some kind of monetary. And she was supposed to be, this is a famous story, so I'll repeat it. She was told to go find this lady in the Los Angeles area who was people had heard needed help. She was a retired teacher. So she went to the address that she had been given, and there was nobody answered the door. She knocked on the door and nobody answered. So she went to the house next door and she said, I'm looking for this woman. And she gave the woman's name and said, I heard she lived at that address. And the guy said, no, there's no woman by that name lives there. So she started to walk away and the man said, oh, you must mean the lady that lives out back in the chicken coop. And so she went out there and she met this teacher that had been a Spanish teacher in Los Angeles of some repute that she knew of and had heard of as being one of the top Spanish teachers. But she had retired, lost all her money in the Depression, and was trying to make it on $40 a month, trying to keep her dignity in the face of all this. She wasn't feeling too well. Dr. Andrus got her help, but that was the incident that made her resolve to do something about it. And as I say in the book, she got angry at first that a retired teacher would have to live that way, and then she got organized. And she decided to create this new organization called the National Retired Teachers Association that teachers all across the country could come together and could advocate for change. And she was quite successful at first. She managed to get pensions increased in many states around the country as the leader of the National Retired Teachers Association, which at that time was in her house in Glendale. And her next goal was to get health insurance for them. And she went to 42 different insurance companies. Everybody thought she was, in fact, the title of the chapter in the book is, They Thought I Was a Crank, because that's what the insurance companies said. They said, older people are uninsurable, we can't do it, there's no way, they'll run us into debt if we try to insure them. But she felt that they could. She felt that all their actuarial tables were based on people that were in hospitals. And she said, most older people aren't in hospitals. And she felt that if you really looked at the bigger picture, they would see that they were insurable. But still, she couldn't find any success with that. So she decided to follow up on the lady with the chicken coop, who was living in the chicken coop, and try to come up with a plan for housing for seniors that would be dignified, that would be affordable, and that would really be there for the needs of older people. So she looked for 2 years for a place that she could put that dream to reality. And she traveled all over the Western United States looking. One day she came to Nordhoff High School to give a talk to try to raise interest in retired teachers. And she came across this rundown little abandoned inn up on Grand Avenue called Gray Gables. And she said this would be the place that she would do it. So she moved the NRTA to Ojai, founded Gray Gables. She ran that herself while she was running the NRTA, and that's how she came to Ojai.
And it's still going strong.
It's still going strong. It's not run by the NRTA anymore. It was sold, and it's run by a very capable group called the Parsons Group that owns several retirement communities, but they've kept the atmosphere of the place very much the way she wanted it. She wanted older people live there not to feel like they were being warehoused or institutionalized, but to feel like they were at a country club almost. So the atmosphere of Gray Gables was country club living at affordable prices there in Ojai. She picked Ojai also because there was so much going on in the community with the arts center, with local government. There were many, many ways for local people to get involved. And part of her philosophy was to get older people volunteering and involved in the community. And Ojai was the perfect place to do that. Then she had her magazines, which went out to everyone in her group, in which she would publicize this. And Gray Gables was even featured at the 1964 New York World's Fair, where AARP had the first exhibit at a World's Fair dedicated to older people. And they had a scale model of Gray Gables where they talked about it as the future of retirement living. And that's the key point about Dr. Andrus, is she created this incredible organization. She made all these wonderful programs that benefited older people. She did advocacy. But the main thing she did was she changed the image of retirement, and she changed the image of aging. Until she got involved, people were afraid to retire. They feared retirement because they felt that they would lose their ability to be creative, and they felt that they would just be over the hill. And
that was the end of them.
Yeah.
Rocking chair and then.
That would be it. And so she created this whole new image of retirement as dynamic, getting involved. And she encouraged people to volunteer in your communities. AARP provided many of the first volunteers for the Peace Corps and for VISTA, because she felt those were ideal programs for older people to get involved. So that's how she got involved in Ojai. She lived there off and on until she died, but later as AARP got bigger and bigger, she spent more of her time in Washington, D.C. and traveling around the country. So she only got back to Ojai occasionally. And Ojai was too small for their membership organization, so because they had over 1 million people when she died. And so, but she did die. She died in Long Beach, where they had moved their main operations at that time. But she's buried here in Ventura. She's buried at the Ivy Lawn Cemetery there.
Ivy Lawn, another great person, with so many that are buried there.
But one of the things we discovered in this writing this book is that the date they have there for her birth is wrong. They listed her birth as 1884, but we discovered through our research into census records and the records of her applications for various schools that she was actually born 3 years before that. We have no idea why that got changed to 1884.
Well, these things happen, but it sounds like an unsung hero, someone who left a major impact on not only Ojai or Ventura County, but the whole nation.
She benefited everyone because everyone, whether you're 15 years old or 30 years old, you have benefited from what she did because now you have a future beyond retirement. People didn't have that back before she got involved. People really felt that retirement was the end of your creative life. It was the end of being involved. Most people who were over 65 didn't work. They had to go live with their children because they didn't have the resources to keep going on their own. Many people lived in almshouses. The almshouses and poorhouses were active all the way up until the 1940s. And that's why this Gray Gables was such a groundbreaking, pioneering retirement community. She also built, as when AARP came into existence, she built the Acacias, which was a nursing home across the street from Gray Gables. And it was the first modern nursing home in America. And she built a little area there that was assisted living. And that's given credit for the first assisted living organization. So between the three, it was the first what we call continuing care center, where someone can go in when they are independent and they can live on their own, and that would be Gray Gables. And then if they needed some assistance, they could go to the Andrus Apartments, which were assisted living. And then if they needed more medical care and treatment, they could go to the Acacias, which was a nursing home.
For those who've just joined us, we're visiting with Mr. Craig Walker, who's telling us about a unique lady and what she did to found Gray Gables and to help retirement communities throughout the nation and the founding of AARP.
Right, and so what the way that AARP came about is after NRTA, the National Retired Teachers Association, secured these insurance policies. Remember, this was 10 years before Medicare, Medicaid. There was no insurance coverage at all for people over 65. So after she had secured these policies for retired teachers, you can imagine the membership of NRTA just mushroomed.
Of course.
And it just took off, and the numbers doubled and tripled. And then she started getting phone calls and letters from people who weren't retired teachers, who were retired other professions and jobs. Mm-hmm. And they said, well, can't you do the same for us? Can't you get us insurance? And so she thought about it, and she sent a letter out to all the members of NRTA, and she says, don't worry, our main interest is still retired teachers, but we're going to take on this little extracurricular activity, she called it, as a principal of AARP, which would provide insurance. It would be an organization of all older people who are over 55. Now it's 50, but originally it was people over 55. And those numbers just began after she set that up. And it started when she and two or three of her assistants and Jack Fay, who's a lawyer in Ojai, they all met at the Ojai Valley Inn, and they drew up the incorporation papers for AARP. They were filed in Washington, D.C. because she wanted it to be a national organization. Yeah. But it really was born in Ojai, and it came out of the whole programs that she developed. So a lot of programs that she had secured for older people who were just retired teachers now went nationwide for all retired people. And the numbers just started again, doubling and tripling. They said that the Ojai Post Office had to completely revamp all their machinery and procedures just to handle the mail of all the applications coming in. Everybody only had to pay $2 a year to belong, but the amount of correspondence was just enormous. And even the local bank had to hire two or three new people to handle all the deposits of these
$2. Well, how long was AARP in Ojai?
Well, it It was headquartered in Ojai probably for 7 to 10 years. It's kind of hard to pinpoint it because they had several offices. They had the office in Ojai. They had an office in Washington, D.C. that handled a lot of their advocacy and legislative lobbying work. Mm-hmm. And they also had an office in Long Beach and an office in Fort Lauderdale in Florida. So a lot of times the various functions got moved around. But there was most of this time in the early 1960s when most of the work for AARP, which was founded in 1958, was handled in Ojai.
Huh.
And even the publication of that magazine that was going out to a million people was handled out of the Ojai post office.
That's quite remarkable.
Right.
And most people don't realize the impact that the one community, Ojai, had on the fabric of the whole nation, and this one unique person.
That's right. I like to think that the community of Ojai had played an important role in her developing this new image of aging, because it was the crucible, I think, of how her social programs got started. And there's something about the character of Ojai that I think got folded into this. In fact, people asked her one time why she started it in Ojai, why she came to Ojai, and she said, yeah, her comment was, Ojai is a small town with a big vision. And her vision was pretty big, because her vision was to transform the lives of older people, which she felt was a tragedy, not only for the older people, but for the nation, because yeah, she saw older people as the largest human resource that was going completely unused in our country, that these people were being marginalized. And she felt that it was her job to get those people back into the mainstream of American life. And she realized she not only had to change the thinking of other people, and she said one time, we can't wait for younger people to take care of the needs of older people because we don't have that much time.
Yeah.
She said, we've got to do it. And so it was her and her group of older people that put all these programs together. She was very proud of the fact that AARP never took any government handouts. They weren't dependent on the government. It was all self-supporting. The Gray Gables and the Acacias and all those institutions and programs were all self-supporting by their own organization. And she lobbied hard when Medicare was being developed. She didn't want it just to be a government program. She wanted it to have a lot of choice in it, because she was a big believer in choice and felt that older people had a right to be able to choose what insurance they took. And so just to come up with a one-size-fits-all, she didn't like. There was some people, though, that wanted a government program. The unions and some other groups were advocating for that. So she came in and really created the program we have now, which is a compromise between the two. As you know, we have Plan A, which is a provided program, but then Plan B, which is doctors' coverage, is voluntary. Mm-hmm. And she also didn't want it to be through Social Security. A lot of people wanted this program to be Social Security, but she felt that would leave a lot of people out, not the least of which was teachers, because teachers don't pay into Social Security. So she felt that would leave them out if they needed care. So she helped to influence it to become a separate program from Social Security, which it is. And she also realized that that Medicare would just provide the basics, and that people could still choose their supplements and their supplemental programs. And that's what it is now. As a retired person myself, I get my Medicare, but I can choose from a number of different programs, pay a little more if I want a little more care. So I think in a lot of ways, her philosophy got put into the program, even a Medicare that we all have today.
I would think that Ojai would be an ideal place for an experimental program like this that would really flourish in that environment.
It did. It really did. And at first, she got a little resistance from the city council. She was very good at, I think it came from her years as a principal, where talking to kids, she helped them to choose the right path and think it was their idea.
Ah.
You know? And so that was the way it was with the Ojai City Council when she went with her plan to put in a retirement home. This was back in 1954. She said there was some resistance to the idea of setting that up, but somehow in the end, they found themselves doing the way, acting the way she wanted them to. And she really involved, she got involved in the community of Ojai as well. She mm-hmm. opened up Gray Gables just like a settlement house. She opened it up to the community. They had a lot of events there that the community was invited to. During the Ojai festivals, they put on events during the tennis tournament. They housed tennis players. Ojai, the Gray Gables has the first peace pole for the Ojai Valley. They were the people that lived there were very involved in the community, not only by opening up Gray Gables, but also going out and serving on boards, being docents in the local museum, just becoming involved in the community. And I think Ojai has always been accepting of various groups and individuals who have come, and they embraced her, and she did so much. And the city council that had been resistant, she took great satisfaction in the fact that 6 years later, after they'd been going, they gave her and her residents a special commendation for all they'd done for the people of Ojai.
There should be some movement for a statue or some sort of commemoration for this unique person.
Yes, very much.
What she's done.
And what's interesting is that she was practically forgotten. When I started researching her, there was nothing in the Ojai history books about her. There was very little in any of the museum archives about her.
Huh.
It was almost as if that page of Ojai's history was gone, and that's one of the things that motivated me, was that she should be back in Ojai's history, but also America's history, because she really was a civil rights leader. She was a woman who achieved so much for mm-hmm. her era. When you think about it, to think that it was a woman back in the 50s who started the largest nonprofit organization, and one that's become so successful, it didn't just wither and die when she died. It went on to become, now it has 38 million people as members, and it's a very strong and powerful group that looks after the interests of older Americans.
I would think that someone should directly put up a statue or a monument, or maybe see about getting a government stamp to honor this unique person.
Exactly.
And all of her contribution.
Right.
She literally changed the face of the nation.
She did. She changed America. She was a social reformer.
Did she ever marry?
She never married. When she was a young woman, she knew she wanted to do some good in the world. She got that from her father, and she wanted to be a social reformer. When she was a child, her idol was a man named Peter Cooper, who started the Cooper Union in New York. And mm-hmm. he was a man that created this whole free college for anybody that wanted to come. And so he made this with his wealth that he had earned. And she liked that idea, and she wanted to do good too. And she wanted to be an educator. Her father told her, you know, if you really want to do something, you probably can't marry. You know, because in those days, you'd be relegated to the house and wouldn't be able to really have the freedom to do the kinds of things that she wanted to do. But when she was in her 80s, she was giving a speech, and a reporter asked after the speech, you know, have you ever married? And she says, no, but there's still time. I think she was like 82 at the time. So she had a very wonderful sense of humor. Jack Fay, who's still alive in Ojai, was the lawyer who helped draw up the incorporation papers. He said she had a wonderful charisma about her. He said when she walked into a room, everybody would be chit-chatting in the room, and when she walked in, the room would go silent. But she wasn't loud or brash in her movement to create a better life for older people. She never staged protests. She never got angry. She never got into conflict. She never pit one group. She always wanted to bring people together. And that the testament to that was there were two congressmen. There was Melvin Laird, who was a congressman that went on to become Nixon's Secretary of Defense. And then there was John Fogerty. And Laird was a Republican and Fogerty was a Democrat. And together, they worked with her to create the Older Americans Act of 1965, which helped to lay out a lot of the programs that would be enacted during Lyndon Johnson's Great Society. The three goals that she had was to bring independence, dignity, and purpose to the lives of older Americans. Independence, to be able to live on their own, to be able to achieve things. Dignity, to be able to live in a respectable life, not in a chicken coop. And purpose. I think she felt that having a purpose was one of the most important things for people. That's really made the difference between continuing to grow in life, no matter what your age, or slowly beginning to become rigid thinkers. Unfortunately, she died before one of her dreams to end mandatory retirement for people 65, but eventually we got that. There was no discrimination. There could be no age discrimination. And the interesting thing is that as an educator, she was every bit as wonderful and as had so many achievements. If she had just retired as an educator, she would still be remembered because she really helped to create the modern high school. When you go back and read about it, what she did, she took high schools from being basically academies that were there to feed students to colleges and turned them into the comprehensive schools with vocational education, with clubs, with student activities, with all the things that we think of. A lot of those were pioneering efforts on her part. And then when she retired, she just went on and changed her focus and achieved even more.
Sounds like a wonderful person. Now, where can people get your book?
Well, the Ojai Museum is ordering them as we speak, but they can also get it on Amazon, or they can...
Now, what's the title again?
Ethel Percy Andrus, One Woman Who Changed America.
I love the subtitle,
yeah.
One Woman Who Changed America.
Yes.
So you can get that on Amazon?
That's right.
And you'll have them at the Ojai Valley Museum?
Yes, we'll have them there.
Sounds like a fascinating project to get this particular woman's story out into the public and to get the AARP to publish this book and get the story out so more people realize her contribution. And maybe others can follow in her footsteps and upon them make perhaps even more needed changes in our society.
Well, she definitely showed that one person can make a difference.
Very much, very much. Thank you very much for talking about it, Mr. Walker. Glad to have you here. I'm certainly going to go to Ojai and get a copy of this when the museum has them.
Thank you.
Thank you for viewing another episode of Studio Sessions. Join us next time as we highlight other unique and special people who've left a contribution to what is Ventura County. Richard Sennett signing off. Until the next time.